what they do at all the camps for the kids. They put a timer up, and that's what the kids usually do.
Good morning. I'm so glad you're here. Have you read a verse and when you're done reading it, you're going, that doesn't make sense? I was reading about Job this week and he went through all of his losses. And then in Job 1:20, it says this. At this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship. It didn't say to worship, it said in worship. And that phrase fascinated me, in worship. And then Psalm 90, let me get another one. Psalm 95, verse 6. David writes something similar. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let's kneel before the Lord our Maker. In worship. So maybe worship isn't an event as much as it's an attitude. So why would Job worship God after all of his losses? What a great attitude. And I wonder if it was that attitude that kept Job healthy and strong. We're here to worship. We're here to worship. But we're here in worship. Let's stand up and pray, and let's sing.
Yeah.
song said something interesting. It said, we are the hope of the earth. Our world right now has lost its hope. And I believe that our hope is contagious to the world. Let's pray. Father God, it's so glad to be here in worship. But Father, worship is also an attitude, and right now we submit to you. We recognize you rule and you reign. We recognize you're the ultimate hope of this planet. In the name of Jesus, we pray, amen. You can be seated if you like.
Says in Romans, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with the hope of the power of the Holy Spirit.
Imagine. could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Shaken.
Father, we do love you. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for the guidance, the love, the impact, the conviction that your Holy Spirit provides. We pray now in this service, Lord, that your Spirit would move in our hearts. We pray that you'd be with John as he speaks, that your words would come from him. Thank you again for your love. In Christ's name, amen.
Which of the following two options would you choose? First, would you rather eat the very best food possible for the rest of your life, made by the best chefs in the world, and you only have to pay for one meal a day, but you'd never be satisfied, you'd always be hungry, you'd always be craving more? Would you rather have that? Or would you rather eat the worst food on planet Earth one time and never be hungry again, but also never have a desire to eat food ever again? I mean, think about these decisions, right? So what I'm really asking is, would you rather sacrifice great taste and the enjoyment of eating so you could be satisfied, so you could never be hungry again? Or would you rather sacrifice fulfillment and satisfaction for great taste? That's what's really on the line. And it's an interesting question, because it has multiple layers to it, right? It's not so straightforward. There's a lot to kind of consider. On the one hand, I can experience the most amazing food made by the most amazing chefs in the world, but I'll still always be hungry, constantly having to spend more and more money on food. And the best food isn't cheap, right? You go to the best restaurants in the world, it's costing you an arm and a leg, right? It's not cheap. But even in this scenario, you have to take into consideration that at least part of the reason that food is so good to us is because it satisfies our desire for it, because it fills us, right? And so there's no guarantee that even though it's the most amazing food, that it will taste the best, because we won't have that sense of fulfillment. But on the other hand, you can be satisfied. All you have to do is eat that week-old tuna fish sandwich that just fell out of the dumpster. But eat it, though, and you'll never be hungry again. But at the same time, you'll never have a desire to eat food again. And I don't know about you, but I like to eat. It's fun and it tastes good, right? I eat even when I'm not hungry anyway. But you'd never have a desire to, right? So in my mind, I think neither of these two options are fully satisfactory for me. I wouldn't be content with either, right? Because it would be a sacrifice of some sort to make. I wouldn't be content because if I chose the first option, I'd get frustrated. I'd get even annoyed that I'm eating and eating, but I'm never being quite full, never being filled. And that would be exhausting to me. But on the other hand, never eating again, that sounds like a miserable life, right? God certainly knew what he's doing when he made us to eat, because he knew we'd like it, right? Why do I ask this question? This question is really to show that contentment is often difficult for most of us to find. No matter what options are in front of us, we often find things to be discontent about. Contentment is difficult for us to find. And it doesn't even matter whether we're an optimist, whether we have a positive outlook on life, or whether we're a pessimist with a negative outlook on life. Nothing seems to make us truly and fully content where we're at. And the contentment that we do feel sometimes doesn't always last for very long. It can be very fleeting. It can go away in an instant. But we all try to chase contentment in some way. At least I'm convinced. that most of us try and chase contentment. We try to find contentment in some way. And we typically think we have an idea of what will make us content. If only I got that promotion at my job, then I'd be content. I've been working hard at it. If I got that, I think I'd be content. Or if only I got a raise, I would be content. Or if only I got to see my kids more, or my grandkids more, I'd be content. If only my team won the World Series, I'd finally be content. Charlie knows what that's like from 2016. I promised him I wouldn't mess with him again, but I had to, Charlie. We say these things all the time. If only I had the newest blank, fill in the blank, I'd be content. Newest iPhone, newest computer, newest whatever, we'd be content. But oftentimes those things don't really fulfill us. Because even when we get those things, we often desire more. And we become discontent with what we thought would make us content. But discontentment can look different than that. It doesn't have to just be being discontent with what we have and wanting more. I think that discontentment can be being unhappy with the stage of life that you're in. So it could be for our teens wishing you were 18 so that you were finally done with school and were an independent adult, finally on your own. That is also discontentment. It could be wishing we were on vacation on some tropical island instead of here in the cold, even though it's not that cold outside today. But here in the cold, on some tropical island, we'd be much happier instead of where God has put us presently. You know, this is our last Sunday in our Kingdom Commandments series, and the commandment we're looking at today, the 10th commandment, I think, really addresses this issue of being content versus being discontent. This is a command that God gives us to combat the discontentment that we feel in our lives. This commandment helps us to see why finding contentment where we are presently in our lives and what we have presently is so important. Let's take a look at the 10th commandment found in Exodus 20:17. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. What does this passage have to do with contentment? Well, thanks for asking. I'm glad you asked. The answer to that question is found in the very meaning of the word covet that's used in Exodus 20. This commandment prohibits coveting, but let's be honest, that's a very Christianese type of word. When was the last time you used the word covet in casual conversation with your coworkers or at family dinner? It's not a word that's commonly used. It's not one that's thrown around a lot. And unless someone has been in church for a while, it's a word that's commonly misunderstood from people outside the church. They don't quite know what it means. But the Hebrew word for covet used in Exodus 20:17, it literally means to desire or to crave. That's what it means, to desire or to crave. And it can even mean taking pleasure in something. And I find it interesting in Scripture that it uses the same word to describe the tree that Adam and Eve were tempted with, that they found it desirable. It's the same word for do not covet. It's the same word. I find that interesting. So when the Scripture says do not covet your neighbor's house or your neighbor's spouse, it's talking about a desire that we have for that thing. Don't feel that desire for that thing. Whatever it is that you covet is attractive to you. It's something that you want. What's more, when the New Testament writers quote this passage, when they quote this passage of do not covet in the Greek language, they use the Greek word that is also used for greedy, which I find interesting. So coveting, then, is not just simply having a desire for something, but it's an intense craving for something that you don't have, but that you want. And it's intense. Did I mention that? It's intense. Discontentment and coveting, in my mind, they go hand in hand. Because why covet something unless you're discontent with what you have presently? Or why covet being somewhere else when you're not, if you're happy with where you are? Right, we're discontent where we're at, so we want to be where somebody else is. The idea behind coveting is that the person who covets thinks their life would be better if they had the thing that they're coveting. They think their life would be happier, more fulfilling. Take the examples in Exodus 20:17, for example. Coveting your neighbor's house. The idea is that the person who covets their neighbor's house thinks they'll be happier if they had their neighbor's house, because clearly it's so much more luxurious and nicer than their own. And so to them, that would be more fulfilling. But discontentment is certainly the driving force behind coveting. So this commandment can be seen, and I think ought to be seen, as a warning against discontentment. Because discontentment is dangerous. It's dangerous to us spiritually. So God is trying to warn us about the danger of discontentment. But what are those dangers? I see four spiritual dangers of being discontent that I want to take a look at this morning. The first danger of discontentment is that discontentment opens the door for envy and jealousy. I think this one's pretty obvious. When we are discontent with what we have or what stage of life that we're in, we are opening the door for envy and jealousy to come into our hearts. And that's very dangerous, because envy can cause us to do great evil that we never thought we were capable of, so that we might have something that we don't have, something that doesn't belong to us, but what we want. We want that thing. You see, envy is wanting what another person has and feeling badly that I don't have it. Envy is disliking God's goodness to somebody else and dismissing God's goodness to me. Envy is desire plus resentment, I think. And it's anti-community. It's very individual-focused. It's not focused on the good of other people. Paul said that we are to rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. But envy causes me to mourn when others rejoice and to rejoice when others mourn. Envy is dangerous because it is opposed to other people. Sins like greed and lust are simply about the gratification of my desires. But envy not only seeks self-gratification, but it seeks to diminish the one that I envy, to ruin the one that I envy. It takes it a step further. See, envy is primarily a sin of the eye. It makes my brother's piece of cake look better and more delicious than my own, and so I want it. See, a child may have hundreds of toys. But envy makes that one toy that a sibling asked to play with the most desirable of them all. No, you can't play with that. That's my favorite toy. Even though they never play with it and haven't picked it up for months. When it comes to envy, the eyes have it. And I think that Syndrome, who was formerly called Incrediboy in the film The Incredibles, is one example of envy's futility and the envier's inferiority. Early in the film, Incrediboy is an ardent but annoying admirer of the superhero Mr. Incredible. Having been spurned and his inferiority openly acknowledged, he launches on a lifetime's work of killing off superheroes, while at the same time creating a machine that only he, with his superior technological props, can defeat. Right, he spends all his energy trying to make himself into an imitation superhero, and his plan, as revealed to Mr. Incredible, was simple. Perfect the machine, defeat it in a mock battle to win acclaim, and then sell his technology to the masses. Because in his mind, if everyone can be super, then no one will be. And that's envy. I don't want anyone to be, because I'm not. If everyone's super, then no one will be, so then I'm not inferior anymore. That's envy, and that's the danger of envy. Now, jealousy is so closely related to envy that I included it in the same category, because it's sometimes the driving force behind envy. But Scripture warns us about the danger of both jealousy and envy. First, in Job chapter 5, verse 2, it says, "For anger slays the foolish, and jealousy kills the simple." Jealousy kills the simple, it says. It can kill us spiritually It can also kill us physically if we let it go too far. But secondly, Proverbs 27:4 says, "Wrath is fierce and anger is a flood, but who can stand before jealousy?" Jealousy will overtake us if we even give it a foothold in our hearts. It will make its way in forcefully and ruin us spiritually. It's deadly to our spiritual health just as much, if not more, than it is to our physical health. We must stay away and guard ourselves from it. That's why elsewhere in Scripture, it says in James 3:16, "For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder and every evil thing." Jealousy leads us to every evil thing. Envy and jealousy are dangerous because they destroy us and they dehumanize the very people that God made. Instead of rejoicing in the goodness of God and who He is, we are jealous of those who receive the blessings of God while ignoring the blessings He's given us in our lives, the many blessings He's already given us. And that's why it's so dangerous. The second danger of discontentment, I believe, is that discontentment leads to complaining. Discontentment leads to complaining. Complaining is easy to do, and we're all guilty of it. Sometimes I think we don't even recognize when we're doing it at times. We're just kind of venting, but it's really complaining. This is particularly true when things don't seem to go our way. We all have a tendency to complain about the many things we are unhappy with in our lives. We complain about our spouse, we complain about our kids, we can complain about our teachers, we complain about our bosses, etc. But this comes from a place of discontentment. And complaining is not God's will for His people. The Apostle Paul writes this in Philippians 2:14-15. "Do all things without complaining or arguments, so that you will prove yourselves to be blameless and innocent, children of God above reproach, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you appear as lights in the world." God wants us to be blameless and innocent. That is His will for our lives. But this verse in Philippians, it makes it clear that complaining does not make us blameless and innocent. Because I don't know about you, but when I tend to complain, I tend to say a lot of dumb stuff that can be used against me and definitely held against me. But more than that, we also prove that by complaining that we have no control over our own words or over our tongues, which is also God's will for us. James 3:2 says, "For we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to rein in the whole body as well." We are a more complete Christian when we have control over our tongues and over what we say. Complaining is dangerous because it gives our God a bad reputation. I don't know if you've ever thought about it that way, but it's dangerous because it gives our God a bad reputation. The world is listening to us at all times. When we complain, see, we represent the name of Jesus, and when we complain, that puts a bad taste in the world's mouth of who Jesus is and what He is like. I've told the story before, but I remember eating at a hibachi place after church Sunday morning with Angelina, and there was a group of older women who clearly just came from church because they were talking about church, and they were just complaining about every little thing that the waiter did and that people in the church just did that morning. And I remember Angelina saying that if I wasn't a Christian and that was the only taste of Jesus I had, I'd want nothing to do with it. Complaining gives Jesus a bad reputation. It puts a bad taste in the world's mouth of who He is. And so it's dangerous for that reason. The third danger of discontentment is that we start to play the comparison game. We start to play the comparison game. Discontentment causes us to look at others around us who are happy and who have it all together and then we begin to idolize them. We look to them as the standard of what we need to do in order to achieve happiness. When we don't meet that standard, and you never will meet that standard, we become increasingly more discontent with the life that we've been given by God. See, I think comparison is the root of most of the misery that we feel in life. Comparison makes it impossible to view ourselves from any sort of godly perspective. It is an absolute snare for the soul to play the comparison game. First, when we compare ourselves with those we perceive to be better than we are in any given area, the comparison produces a sense of inferiority and insecurity in us. So whenever we see those people, they become reminders that we don't have what it takes and that we're falling behind. So we feel that we must work and we must strive to keep up. Yet the harder we try to do that, the more we're caught in a cycle of despair. See, comparison erodes our self-worth, our sense of worth, and our self-esteem. But it has a flip side too. When we compare ourselves with people we perceive to be inferior to us, we are filled with a sense of superiority. The people around us become constant reminders of how good we are and how well we're doing compared to them. And judgment and pride can creep in that way. See, those controlled by forces of comparison, those who are constantly comparing themselves, are unstable and often have insecure souls. And so they play the comparison game. And that is why it is so dangerous. In Galatians 6:4, Paul tells us to focus only on ourselves. He says, "But each one must examine his own work, and then he will have reason for boasting, but to himself alone, and not to another." See, we must let our lives be our lives. And we must let their lives, the people we compare ourselves to, we must let their lives be their lives. See, the life that we have been given has been given to us by God. And the life that they've been given has been given to them by God. And there are no similarities, because my life is different from theirs. God's given me a different life than their life. And so there's no sense of comparing something that's not similar at all. So we best stay focused on the life that God gave us. But at the end of the day, Scripture says it's foolish to compare ourselves with others. 2 Corinthians 10:12 says, "For we do not presume to rank or compare ourselves with some of those who commend themselves. But when they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they have no understanding." When we play the comparison game, Scripture says we have no understanding. In other words, there's a lack of wisdom there. There's foolishness in that. There's no understanding. And that's why it can lead to dangerous things. The last danger of discontentment that I see is that discontentment causes bitterness and anger. It causes bitterness and anger. See, when we start getting envious of others and jealous of other people, when we start to complain about not having what someone else has or not being where somebody else is, and when we start comparing ourselves to them, bitterness and anger begin to take root in our heart. See, envy and jealousy, they come in through the door of our heart, but bitterness and anger take root in our heart. And that's exactly why it's so dangerous. Scripture warns us about letting bitterness take root in us. Hebrews 12:5 says, "See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many become defiled." When bitterness takes root in our hearts, according to that passage, we become defiled. We become unclean and corrupted. It hurts our relationship with God, and it hurts our relationship with other people. Bitterness towards someone leads to hatred of them. And we know that God is love. It is not pleasing to God when we store up bitterness in our hearts. In fact, when we do this, I think Scripture's clear that when we store up bitterness in our hearts and when we're angry at somebody in our hearts, it affects our worship of God. And in a way, it affects our acceptability, our worship's acceptability in the eyes of God. In Matthew 5:23-24, Jesus says, "Therefore, if you are presenting your offering at the altar," in other words, worshiping, "and there you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your offering there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and present your offering." In other words, if you come before God to worship him with bitterness in your own heart towards someone else, then don't be fooled. God is not pleased with your offering of worship. Jesus says, first go and be reconciled, or remove that bitterness from your heart, and then come and offer your worship to God. That's why when Jesus is asked, what's the greatest commandment, he gives two commandments. Jesus was not bad at math. He knew how to count. Love God and love others. He's trying to make it clear that if we don't love others, then we can't really claim that we love God. Bitterness defiles us, and it defiles our worship of God if we let it take root in our lives. The same is true with anger. James 1:20 says, "For a man's anger does not bring about the righteousness of God." It is for this reason that Paul commands this following passage to the church in Ephesus. It says, "All bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and slander must be removed from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, compassionate, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you." Staying in our discontentment is dangerous because it allows bitterness and anger to take root in our hearts. And our relationship with God and with others can be absolutely wrecked by letting it stay there. So what do? We know discontentment with what we have and the stage of life that we're in is dangerous. But how can we be content with what we have and where we're at? How are we able to do that? How can we overcome discontentment when we're tempted by it or even struggling with it? And how can we discover true contentment? I see two ways, according to the Bible, that we can overcome discontentment and be totally content with what God has blessed us with. The first way we can discover contentment is recognize that what we have is a gift from God. We can discover true contentment by recognizing that what we have is a gift from God. When we start feeling jealous or envious of someone, and we start coveting them because they have something we want but don't have, remember that what you do have are gifts of God. God has given each of us exactly what we need. And sometimes we need to make the important distinction between what we need and what we want. God knows what we need, and he provides it for us. But God also gives us blessings that we don't need, and praise him for giving us those things. We get a raise at our jobs because of the work we're doing, and we can use that extra money in any way we want. That's an example of God blessing us with something we don't necessarily need. See, as Americans, we like to make enough money to be able to enjoy a comfortable lifestyle or a certain lifestyle and to have whatever we want, but survival is what we need. Any form of food, shelter, clothing, and jobs. And God has certainly given us all of those things as a gift because he loves us. But he gives us even more than these things. He gives us more than we need as a blessing because he cares for us. Matthew 6:26-32 says, "Look at the birds of the sky. They do not sow nor reap, nor gather crops into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more important than they? And which of you, by worrying, can add a single day to his life's span? And why are you worried about clothing? Notice how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor, nor do they spin thread for cloth. Yet I say to you that not even Solomon, in all his glory, clothed himself like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today, and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, will he not much more clothe you? You of little faith. Do not worry then, saying, what are we to eat, or what are we to drink, or what are we to wear for clothing? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. God cares about us. He loves us and provides us with what we need. So we need to recognize that everything we have and everything we've been given is a gift from God. James, the brother of Jesus, says in James 1:17, every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shifting shadow. God has blessed us with what we have, and he has blessed others with what they have. If we recognize that God is the giver of all we have, we are much more likely to find contentment with what we have, and we can even learn to appreciate the things that others have that we don't have, because we know that God is the one who has blessed them with that. And what is more, when we are discontent with the gifts God gives us, it's almost as if we are telling God, what you've given me isn't good enough, and I don't trust your provision for me. But when we recognize this truth, that what other people have, God has blessed them with, what we have, God has blessed us with, we are more likely to rejoice with those who rejoice. The second way that I think we can discover contentment is seek God's kingdom. If you want to discover contentment, seek God's kingdom. We can find it by seeking his kingdom. See, one of the greatest roadblocks to contentment in many people's lives is selfishness. The reality is, when all we do is seek out and pursue our own happiness and our own contentment, we'll never fully be content. But when we choose to seek God's kingdom and the advancement and growth of his kingdom, we can find true and we can find full contentment. Looking again at Matthew 6, but this time let's look at Matthew 6:33, where we left off. It says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided to you. Seek first his kingdom, and all these things will be given to you. What things? The things that we need and the blessings and the gifts that God pours out on us. We find contentment in seeking God's kingdom because we know it's something that is eternal, that never changes, and that can never be taken from us if we pursue it. So no matter what stage of life we're in, whether we're a teen or we're a young adult or we're single or we're married or we're divorced, it doesn't matter. God's kingdom can satisfy us because it's a constant and it's of greater worth than anything this world has to offer. And when we focus on what is of greater worth, when God's kingdom is worth more to us than anything else, why would we desire lesser things? But in order to seek God's kingdom, a change in our mindset is required. We can't seek God's kingdom while our thoughts are consumed with the things of this world. Or even if the things of this world have our affection, we can't seek his kingdom. The Apostle Paul says in Philippians 4:8-9, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, think about these things. As for the things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Paul tells us to think about admirable things, things that are worthwhile. He puts it another way in Colossians 3:1-3. Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. We can seek God's kingdom only by changing our focus. Instead of focusing on earthly things and material possessions, we shift our focus to heavenly things. And that passage in Philippians 4, if you're wondering what are heavenly things, that passage gave us a whole list of things to focus on that you can use. But we'll never discover contentment unless we shift our focus and our priorities to God's kingdom. Seek first his kingdom, Jesus says. So if you're struggling to find contentment this morning, if you feel discontent with what you have or with where you're at in life right now, I invite you to commit yourself this morning to seeking God's kingdom first. Jesus promises fulfillment. He promises satisfaction and rest when we come to him and declare him as the Lord of our lives. And coming to Jesus and declaring him as the Lord of our lives is something we don't just do once, but we should do daily. And if you've already made that decision to commit yourself to Jesus and his kingdom by making him Lord of your life, but you find yourself dealing with discontentment, I encourage you to recommit yourself to his kingdom this morning. As I close in prayer in just a moment, pray with me and recommit yourself to your Lord. And if you truly pursue his kingdom, you will find contentment. If you want to pray with somebody about it, you know, if you want somebody to talk to about it, then you can make your way over to our Next Steps prayer room on your left. Someone will be there to pray with you and talk with you. But perhaps this morning you've never committed yourself to Jesus and declared him as Lord of your life. If that's you this morning, then I encourage you also to make your way to our Next Steps prayer room on your left. You can do that during my closing prayer. And you can learn more about the contentment and the satisfaction that he can offer you that I've talked about this morning. See, he's offering it to you for free. The only thing you have to do is accept it and commit yourself to him, declaring him as Lord, as your Lord and Savior, meeting him in the waters of baptism. So let's stand. And as I pray, if you feel you need to talk with somebody, or if you want to accept Christ, then make your way over to our Next Steps prayer room. But I encourage all of you to pray with me that as a church, let's commit ourselves to seeking God's kingdom and being content, so that when people visit this church or see us in the community, they wonder how we're so content with the life we have and how they can find that contentment as well. There's strength in numbers, and so won't you commit yourself with me this morning to seeking God's kingdom and chasing the contentment that he offers instead of finding contentment in earthly things. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the commandment to not covet, because it teaches us, Lord, that we should be content with what we have. Lord, you are the giver of all things, and you've gifted us with what each of us possess. Forgive us, Lord, for the times that we want something that has not been given to us, where we show that we don't trust your provision and we want to take it into our own hands. Lord, thank you for the blessings that you give to us that we don't need. And I pray that we can value those things and be content with those things, understanding that we don't deserve anything from your hand, but you give us things because you love us. Help us to be content with that. And Lord, I pray that if there's anyone struggling with finding contentment, that you will help them, that this church can be a support for them and encourage them in the ways of your kingdom, to find contentment there rather than elsewhere. But Lord, won't you be with them? Won't your spirit dwell in their heart and help them to be able to find that contentment that you desperately want each of us to find in our lives, the lives that you've given us. Pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. You can be seated for our time of communion.
I've been blessed to be around some very wise people, and one of them is John Strauss. And John taught us one day in class, there's two ways you can look at the law. You can look at the law by the letter of the law, which means you take it for exactly what it says. Or you take the law and you look at the spirit of the law, which is a general principle. Well, I'm going to take the commandment here and take it by the letter of the law. And let's see how well I do. Exodus 20, verse 17. You shall not cover your neighbor's house. Mine's nicer than his. I've got a two-car garage. God's good. You shall not cover your neighbor's wife. Nope. You shall not covet his male servant or his female servant. He doesn't have any. I am great right now. You shall not covet his ox or donkey. He doesn't have any. I am doing great. Woohoo! Uh-oh. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. About a year ago, Brian, my neighbor, bought a new car. It's my wife's favorite color. Do you know what's your favorite color? Bright green. He brought a bright green Dodge Charger. Hemi. This baby can fly. I've got a Kia. What in the world? His Charger, my Kia. I could covet. I don't. But here's what's interesting. As we take communion, Jesus said that he coveted to take the communion meal with us. Luke 22:15. And he said to them, I earnestly desire to eat the Passover meal with you before I suffer. Jesus earnestly desired to celebrate communion with his disciples before he went to the cross. Wow. As we take communion, we should earnestly desire to be closer to God. We should earnestly desire to learn more about his love and his sacrifice. Let's pray. Father God, as we take communion, we're doing something that you earnestly desired to do before you died on the cross. Father, it's a reminder of your sacrifice for us. And Father, as we take this, we remember your body that was broken for us. We remember your blood that was spilled for us for one purpose, for our salvation. Father, thank you for being a God who loves us, but being a God who died for us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Oh.
Well, thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you to those who joined us on the live stream this morning as well for joining us that way, for worshiping with us. Just a few announcements before we conclude service today. Church movie night is this evening at 6:30. So please come and join us, or at 6 o'clock rather, not 6:30, at 6 o'clock. So won't you come and join us for that? There are still tickets on the table available for you to take and to give to friends or neighbors who maybe you haven't invited yet. That might still come out, so feel free to take as many as you want to hand out. But we're going to have a great time of fellowship. It's going to be a great movie. Michael's given it a 5-star review, so you know it's going to be good. Our children's minister, right? So he knows what he's talking about. So now we do have a food drive for Reach York County Ministry. That will be, there's a table over there that you can bring canned foods to. So please, if you're able to, come and bring a canned food item with you so we can donate that to them for their ministry. They would really appreciate that, and we could do some good work in the community through them, through those donations. Come and be fed this Wednesday is our fall festival, Come and Be Fed. So we're going to have a meal like usual, but after the meal, there's no fellowship groups. Okay, I know we've got some questions on that. There's no fellowship groups this Wednesday, but everyone is still invited to come and participate in Michael's Fall Festival. He encourages you to. It's in your bulletin. I got it underlined. Adults are still encouraged to attend and play Clue for a chance to win a prize. I will be there without shame playing for a prize. So won't you join me for the Fall Festival trying to defeat me, the reigning champion, or will be the reigning champion of Clue. But no fellowship groups after that. Just want to make that clear. The menu is fried chicken and side dishes. It sounds really great. So please join us for time of fellowship there. This weekend, we were going to have an Ides packing party, but we've had to postpone that due to some scheduling issues. So won't you make sure that if that's on your calendar, don't show up this Saturday for that. It's not happening. We are rescheduling it to sometime in 2023. So keep your eyes open for that. We'll let you know when we have a time rescheduled. But this weekend, it's been postponed, okay? The last thing that I want to share is that we've heard that Wally Draper has had a stroke, and so he's in the hospital. I don't know much more than that, but if you could keep him in your prayers and maybe send some encouraging flowers or notes his way, I'm sure he would appreciate that. The last thing is Deborah Carpenter wants to make an announcement, so go ahead.
Yes, on the Friday after Thanksgiving, a group of us are going, and I'm not going to be able to do that this time, but a group from here is going up to the Chicago area to a processing center to work there for Operation Christmas Child. This is the first time we've gone to this one that's closest to us. We've been always going to the one in Charlotte before. Because some of us cannot go on that one, I'd like to know if anyone would be interested in going later on that weekend. It just doesn't work for a lot of people with family coming in. So if you would be interested in coming, I would like to go. I think Penny would like to go. There are a few of us who would like to go who cannot do it that weekend. Just come and talk to me. We don't have a set date, and that will help us figure out when we can go. It's not hard. We would probably drive up one morning, work a 4-hour shift that afternoon, stay overnight, and then get up the next morning, work a morning shift, and drive home the next day. And it's a lot of fun. It shows you the whole process. We pack the boxes here, and then we ship them away. Now you'll know what happens to them. Because when they leave the processing center, they go all over the world from there. And it's a very, very cool experience, and I invite you to come and talk to me about it, and let's get a group up and go.
All right. Well, won't you stand with me, and I'll pray us out and be dismissed. Let's pray. Father, thank you once again for this morning, Lord, for being with us, for allowing us to come and gather together, Lord. It's one of the best parts of the week, and it's such a great way to start the week off, Lord, of being together with your family and your house worshiping you. Lord, we do want to lift up Wally Draper right now during this time and just pray for his health. We know, Lord, that he has suffered a stroke, and we don't know the full details of that, but we just want to ask for your hand to be with him and to be with his family right now, and that we can be a source of encouragement, Lord, and for them. But we just pray that you'll be with him, and Lord, bring him to healing according to your will. Father, be with us as we go into the world. Help us to be lights. Help us to take the message that was brought to our hearts this morning and to apply that into our lives so we can be an example for this entire world of what it is that you want, and we can bring others to Christ through that way. It's in his name. Amen. Chairs do need to come up, so if you could help us with that.